Hey, Jody.
Hey, Cindy. I am trying to get all of slides up on the correct page. Now, so now. Cindy, just to confirm, are you able to see my screen? It should be the.
Yes, it is the opening slide.
Okay, and just the slide, not the full.
That is correct, because normally that's what I do.
Okay.
So you're in good shape. And are you going to welcome everybody?
I will. I'll start out with a welcome, let everybody know that
They're at the right place.
there's the right place and that we're recording, although I think it asked that when we started the meeting or when you
Okay.
joined.
Okay. Good deal.
Gonna stop sharing for a second. Try to get things shifted around. I've got my monitors up here, and for some reason, it always wants to go actually over to my actual laptop. So I've had to squint and try to look over there to get the all the dialog box going. So let's see here.
Morning, Robert.
Hey, good morning, Cindy.
When technology fails, I'll just move my laptop over here in front of me instead of having to try to figure out how to actually get it over on the correct monitor.
You're back on. That's good.
Yep, we should be good now. I think I've got everything jammed here in front of me on this on my desk.
Thank you.
Good morning, Marcella.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm good. How are you?
Doing pretty well.
Excellent. We'll give folks, let's see, I guess Ian is going to be joining.
Yes, he will be.
Okay, perfect. We still got a few minutes here. So
yeah.
And just to confirm, on the screen that I'm sharing, it's actually the one that has the full screen slide, correct? It doesn't have the speaker notes and that kind of thing.
That is correct.
Okay. Zoom is showing that I'm sharing a different screen, but as long as that's what you guys are seeing, that works for me.
All I'm seeing is the very first slide, which I would not expect any notes to be on.
Yeah, there's no notes, but PowerPoint has like the little speakers notes if you're running two monitors. So I just wanted to make sure that was, you guys weren't just getting a small version of the slide. Perfect.
So you're in good shape.
Okay.
It's hard to believe this is already October.
I know.
It's like, wow.
I know.
It's hard to believe we're a month away from the board meeting.
That's very hard to believe.
Yep.
I was talking with Kelly Mears. We've got a lot of stuff to get together. Actually, I need to talk with you a little bit about some of that after. Maybe not today, but maybe at some point next week. Just making sure that we've got the correct meals coordinated with the hotel versus what is. I have not been to a year-end board meeting. Kelly nor I have been to a year-end board meeting, so we wanted to make sure we had we didn't throw anybody for a loop.
Okie dokie.
Now that you brought that up, so it's happening in person, right?
So far, we're planning on being in person.
Okay, so I wanted to ask you, since it's over on Monday after lunch with the tour of the hotel, is it possible if I don't attend Monday, so I come only for the weekend?
You're there Saturday for the strategic planning session, right?
Yes, and Sunday, but I was... Yes. I was thinking it's best for me if I leave Sunday night.
If you could leave Sunday night would be fine, as long as you get the whole session in on Sunday.
Yeah.
I would be happy with that.
Okay. So I'll plan accordingly. Okay. Thank you very much.
I understand. My husband used to teach at UT, so I know what it's like trying to take care of stuff.
Yes, teaching and having a 1 year old doesn't help.
I know. Trust me, I remember it well. So,
we've had quite a few people join. We're still a minute or two before the top of the hour, so we'll give it another minute or two, and then we'll get started. For those that are here, if you don't mind, just kind of drop in the chat window there, what school or section that you're associated with, just so that we can kind of see who we have represented here.
I'm Bob Stammer with Vanderbilt. I haven't dropped into the chat window, so somebody will have to do that for me.
Okay. Hey, Bob, thanks for joining us.
No problem. Broken neck and all.
You doing any better, Bob?
I got a good report last time from the neurosurgeon. He said that I could actually take this brace off, which I will do as long as I'm sitting, but I have to be careful. And I go back the end of October, And he, the last visit, he told me that he looked like if I behaved myself, I wouldn't have to have the fusion surgery. So that was the best news.
And yes.
He said all the compound fractures had not healed, but looked like structurally sound and my head wasn't going to fall off my shoulders. How's retirement?
Loving it, but I am so busy.
Well, I'm the same way. Jane's already given me grief. She says, I thought you were going to retire, Bob. So,
but it has been, in spite of COVID, I mean, it's been busy and hectic. But anyhow.
Been there, done that. You got a lot to do on your plate.
Yep. So.
On a historical note, I've got all the historical boxes out of my old office, moved downstairs to the structures lab. They're storing it for me. I'm in the process, probably about one day away from moving my old office into a shared office. And then I'm going to get them to bring the boxes up and I'm going to go through them, and things that aren't needed, I'll probably discard, and then I'll get it down to a couple of boxes. Or my intent is hopefully to get a notebook put together for each one of the sections. In other words, just go through all the paper copies that I have, and starting back, you know, whenever in the 60s or 70s, whatever I've got in my little boxes, prepare one for the Tennessee section, Kentucky section, Alabama section, etc.
I think that's a great plan. So charge on. But I also know what a pain it is to go through all that kind of stuff, because I still haven't cleared out all of my office stuff that I have accumulated in my back bedrooms now.
For much of my career, I had administrative appointments. So I had two offices. And then when the first grandchild was born in 2003, came back to one in civil engineering, and it never recovered, combining two offices into one.
Well, it looks like we've got a good crowd, and we've got some more folks joining us, and it's just a few minutes after the top of the hour, so I guess we can go ahead and get started. Thank you for joining us on a Friday, hopefully you're going to get to take away some good information from this webinar or this session. We really intend for it to be very informal. And we're going to go through some stuff, and the thought was that for the education student chapter committee, that we really wanted to kind of help all the student chapters to get a strong start in the semester. As Cindy mentioned, we are, I guess, now halfway through the semester. The college semesters go so fast. We're halfway through the semester, but at least we're in the first part of the academic year, and we want to start building a better relationship with our student chapters. So I'll go through and do some quick introductions. For those of you that have not yet done so, if you don't mind just kind of dropping in the chat window there where what school you're from or what section you're representing and what your role is, just so we can kind of get a good idea of who we have on the call. We'll go from there. Do some quick introductions. I'm Jody Peace. I'm with the Georgia section and working. I'm a co-chair along with Robert Baker, who's also on the call, of the Education and Student Chapter Committee. Also have Cindy Pianchi with us. Cindy is the Southern District President. So she's currently the Southern District President. She is in Knoxville and is a member of the Tennessee section. Robert Baker is also mentioned him. He's in Georgia along with myself. So Robert works for GDOT, Georgia Department of Transportation. And then we also have two Virginia Tech students. We have Marcella Kaplan and Ian, Ian McManus. There he is. Ian McManus, who are joining us. And they're going to talk a little bit about the Student Leadership Summit that's going to be coming up in February. So hopefully everyone can see the slides. There should be a single slide on there that says, it's just a title slide there for Student Chapter Kickoff. I'm going to kind of go through the agenda here. First of all, Cindy's going to give us a quick overview of Southern District. I know some of you as students, you're probably not overly familiar with Southern District. So Cindy's going to give you a little bit of an overview of how Southern District fits into the big picture. I'm going to talk a little bit about roles and responsibilities of different roles within the student chapters and those responsibilities. Robert Baker is going to talk a little bit about the Education Student Chapter Committee, our resources, and kind of the expectations that Southern District has for the student chapter. Then, as I mentioned, we're going to talk a little bit about the Student Leadership Summit that's coming up in a few months now. And then we'll do a calendar review. And then really, the thought is have plenty of time at the end for questions and answers. I will point out, I believe everybody had to acknowledge when you joined the meeting, but we are recording this meeting. And so we will likely be posting this on our YouTube channel just for those. We had several people who mentioned they'd love to be here, but they had meeting conflicts or classes. So we will be posting this on the YouTube channel as well. So I guess I'll turn it over to you, Cindy.
Okie doke, thank you, Jody. This slide, unfortunately, I ran out of time, but if I had done it correctly in decided to make it pretty, you'd see a staircase here. Essentially, what I'm here to explain is once you are no longer a student and you join the profession and actually get a paying job in the transportation arena, there are three levels that exist within the ITE hierarchy. And if you start at the lower left end, you have the section slash chapter. And typically the section is your state. Most of the states are large enough that they are their own sections. Chapter, and this was interesting from my perspective, like if you're from like the state of Rhode Island, because it's such a small state, they're only considered a chapter. But the section is, for the most part, your state. And all of the states meet on a regular basis too. The next phase up is the middle of the screen where you see the Southern District of ITE. And we are composed of 9 states, but we only make up 8 sections. And you'll see that on the next slide. And then that's the district, and that's currently what I'm president of, is that large of an area. And then from there, you move up into the international ITE, which is composed of 11 districts. And that's kind of interesting because in addition to all the districts that the United States makes up, you also have Canada, and then Australia, New Zealand are combined, and then you have the rest of the global picture in terms of what's going on. So as you can see, the Southern District, and this came up 5 years ago when we did our last strategic plan, we consider ourselves the creamy section of the Oreo cookie because we are the communication between international and the actual state sections. So next slide. We'll show you the states that are composed in the Southern District. As you can see, it is the Southeast United States. It does not include Florida. Florida has been combined with Puerto Rico to form their own district. Previously, they had just been their own district. So we have, like I said, 9 states. Louisiana and Mississippi combined make up the Deep South. And the rest, Kentucky, Virginia, Tennessee, North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia, and Alabama. We meet once a year in person, what we call our annual meeting. And then twice a year, our executive board gets together. But all during the year, we have meetings and committee meetings and all kinds of things. The other thing to be aware of in regards to these 9 states, 8 sections, is the fact that 4 of them sections are what we call large and 4 we consider small. And that's based on the number of members that actually belong to each of those areas. The large sections are Georgia, Tennessee, North Carolina, and Virginia. And essentially all 4 of those sections have more than 300 members apiece in those states. The other ones are less than that in terms of what's going on. And I believe Kentucky and Louisiana, I think, are amongst our lowest members. I remember Kentucky was only like around 82 members. So there's quite a bit of diversity, but as a geographic area, we have so much more in common than things that we don't have in common. For me, the Southern District has always been a great place in terms of getting technical information, because there are so many cities and counties that I could relate to on a professional level. Next slide. This is a more complicated slide because this is actually our hierarchy on how we are organized within the Southern District. And the block at the very top up here, that is our executive committee. And that is formed by myself, I'm the president. Allison Michelle is our vice president. Our secretary treasurer is Krista Green. Our international director is Scott Walker. And then our immediate past president is Becky Rogers. Also on that executive committee is Craig Hanchey, and he's our district administrator. And he is our consistent person because he's been our administrator now for, I think he just completed his 11th year. So he's very consistent in terms of making sure we follow what we're supposed to be doing. The officers, we rotate, so we all move up every year. So the only new one that rolls on every year is the new secretary treasurer, and everybody moves up. And the international director is elected every 3 years. So you do have a lot of consistency in terms of leading the troops and what the direction is that we're trying to achieve. And we meet monthly. We do conference calls, which are very helpful in trying to get everything organized. So that's your executive committee. And the only one who is not eligible if we ever take votes is Craig. It is only the five who get to vote. The executive board is composed of the executive committee plus all the section reps who are stacked on the right-hand side of the screen there. And the section representatives, once again, are for every state that you saw on that map. And depending on the size of your state, once again, if you're a small section, it means you had less than the 300 members. So you only get one section representative. If you're larger, you're fortunate and you get two representatives. So that's what's going on there. And that's who makes up the voting membership for as we make policies and decisions on how to spend money and do things like that. But when we hold our board meetings, we also invite our committee chairs because, let's face it, the committee chairs are who actually does the bulk of the work of everything that we do. And what I'm going to do is start on the right-hand side, kind of just giving you a quick overview as to what goes on. The first one is the Local Arrangements Committee, and that changes every year because this is the group that actually hosts the annual meeting that we do every spring. So next year, the meeting is scheduled to be in Louisville, Kentucky. So that's who would be in that block for next year. And like I said, that's a rotating, changes every year. Next to that is the Traffic Bowl committee. And the Traffic Bowl is something you as student members should be interested in because every school that has a student chapter is eligible to participate in the Traffic Bowl and send their winning team from their state to the Southern District to compete for the district championship. Then we have the nominations committee, and that is chaired by a past president. And as you would expect, the nominations are for things for the officers. So we go through that every year. And once again, a lot of these committees are also reflected at the section level because the same type work has to be done and is done. We have a membership committee that's chaired by the current vice president. And basically that's just looking at, you know, what our membership is, how many members we have, what they're composed of. Are they members of a private company as in they work for a consulting firm? Are they a public agency like they work for a Department of Transportation or a city or county government? Those kinds of differentiations, because a lot of times we're trying to reach out to different groups as we proceed with our technical programs and our outreach efforts. Then, let's see, we have our Education and Student Chapter Committee, which is what we are part of here today. Robert and Jody chair that for us currently. And that deals with all the student chapters and everything that's going on with that. So things like the Student Leadership Summit, they answer those questions. They help make the connections for the traffic bowl, for getting information on your contact information to the right resources too, because that's an evolving door in terms of what goes on. And the membership of that changes every year, every semester, because people are constantly graduating and or dropping out of school or getting jobs in the transportation profession. Then we have the awards committee, because every year at our annual meeting, we do give out awards. We give out awards for both the sections and for individual members who have done outstanding work in regards to the transportation profession. And those are people that we want to acknowledge. And once again, that is chaired by past presidents. And that is because they are looking back at the time that they were in office, and they can best address what was going on during their term in office as to who helped the most during that particular year that they're trying to give an award for. We also have an audit committee, and that's to make sure with all of our finances that everything is properly accounted for in terms of the spending, and that there is a paper trail for how the money was spent in case we ever need to do anything, because we actually do have to submit reports to the IRS and whatnot. So very small committee, but very important. Once again, that is obviously chaired by the Secretary Treasurer for the given year that we're in. Last but not least is this last column here on the left, and that is the Member Services Committee. And that is composed of six groups in terms of what's going on, and they do a lot of the work. First one up is the annual meeting, and the annual meeting, folks, is composed, all of these groups here, even the ones across the top, particularly the education one and traffic bowl, we try to get a member from every section on those committees so that there is a direct line of communication between the section and our district in terms of what we're doing and moving ahead on. So we try to do that. The annual meeting committee has previous local arrangements chairs or someone who was very high up in the organization for a previous annual meeting. Once again, we hold those annual meetings once every year, and it rotates between every section. So every 9 years, it comes back to your state. So every time the group changes, but that committee is chair, it's pretty much about half people that have already hosted one. And the next half are people that are in, will be hosting a meeting in the future. Because once again, we're trying to get that consistency element in what we produce so that it's a good event for everybody that attends. Then we have the Information, Communication, and Outreach Committee. That's a mouthful. We call them IC and O to make it easier. And it is what you would suspect. Information, things like our website, communication. We do a lot with, we have a newsletter, we do e-blasts, we have a social media. We put things on YouTube, Twitter, Facebook, all that stuff. We have people that actually get those messages out there. Our outreach effort is a little on the downside, as one might suspect, because for the last year and a half, we haven't been able to do anything in regards to COVID. But outreach is what you would expect. We want people to go out, whether it be, I did this prior to COVID, I used to go talk to kindergartners and first graders about traffic signs, about their colors and shapes and what they mean and everything. So it's from as basic as that to talking to middle school, high school, and college students about the transportation profession. It even includes going out and talking to those like garden groups or whatever. So all of that falls under outreach. So that is what that group does, which is a lot. Then we have our leadership team, and our leadership team is we try to hold small classes because it's a very one-on-one team building type exercise. And these are people that have been identified by their section that they foresee them as future leaders, either as a section or district officer, or based on what they're doing in their career. And we actually have about 14 or 15 modules at this point. We keep adding to it in terms of what goes on. We teach things like how to deal with political leaders, how to deal with this media, how to conduct an effective meeting, visioning, strategic planning, all kinds of stuff, good stuff. Lots of communication classes come out of that. Then we also have a technical knowledge committee. And this group helps the local arrangements committee also, in that if they need help getting speakers for the annual meeting, they're also very much aware of what the hot topics are in transportation. They help make those connections so that we actually put on a good program. They also write articles for our newsletter periodically to keep the membership informed as to what's going on. So that's what they do. Workforce development, what they try to do is figure out what do we need to do to be the best professional transportation folks in the business. So they cover a wide range of things. They try to figure out, you know, what kind of communications do we need? What kind of project management skills do we need? What business skills? What leadership skills? How do we transition from being a student member to a professional member of ITE? Those are the kinds of things that they work on. And last but not least is our young members. And that is, as you would suspect, this is for members who have started out in their professional career. They've either graduated from undergraduate school and or graduate school and are now a professional. Because they're a young member, probably about half of them actually have their license and the other half don't, because of, you know, what the requirements are to get that. But they are all under the age of 35. And for the most part, this group is a very social group because they're trying to get to know each other and they're trying to learn the transportation business. So they're more social than anything, but I'm proud to say that just last month, I had asked them this year to find a topic that they felt that the rest of the overall Southern District membership needed to be aware of and care about and why, and host a session for us. And so last month they brought in speakers to talk about transportation and health. So that's our organization. We are very busy. Everybody meets. These days we all meet by Zoom, but even before COVID hit, we were doing conference calls. So that now it's just a matter of we get to see each other because we Zoom. But that's what goes on. And I think that was my last slide. So next.
Yeah, thank you, Cindy, for giving that overview. I know that's something that as a student, I didn't realize what went on within the Southern District. So thank you for giving that overview. We're going to kind of shift gears a little bit now so that you kind of see the big picture of how we as an education student chapter and how you guys as student chapters fit into the overall organization. Talk a little bit more about the student chapters and some of the players in the student chapters. So you can see this is a table that some of you may have seen if you attended one of the webinars a couple of months ago, but we really have four major roles within the student chapter activities. So we have our student leaders, who are many of you on the call today. Those may be elected student leaders within the student chapter. There may be others that are appointed within the student chapters that are those student leaders. We have faculty advisors, which I know we've got a few of those on the call today. We have the student chapter liaison, which is a fairly new role that ITE has started pushing, which is really a professional, somebody from the section, the state sections, that really crosses over and tries to help the student chapters, helping the student leaders, helping the faculty advisors. Many of the faculty advisors that we have on the call today are active, very active within the Southern District and within ITE, but we do have some schools that have faculty advisors that aren't as active within ITE. So that student chapter liaison is also there to kind of help connect the students to ITE as a whole and to their state section. And then lastly, this ENSC committee, who were there to help out in some of the other roles that Robert's going to talk about a little later. But you can see kind of some of the tasks down through here. I'm not going to run through each one of these because you guys can certainly see them on the slide. And we can send out this slide deck as well. But, you know, planning activities, kind of the day-to-day operations of the student chapters, a lot of that falls on the student leadership, the elected and appointed student leaders. You have your faculty advisors there to help mentor you, provide advice, but really kind of planning the monthly meetings, those day-to-day activities, that's primarily your role and your responsibility. Some of the other things such as developing a student chapter report, preparing for the traffic bowl, again, that's your primary role as student leaders, with support from your faculty advisor, as well as some of the student chapter liaisons. I will mention that, you know, connecting the student chapters, helping you guys connect to the professional organizations, helping prepare for, you know, transitioning to the profession. That's where we kind of transition more into that student chapter liaison leading that. So, and your faculty advisor and also, you know, Robert and myself and the rest of the ENSC committee are there to help support that. Go to the next slide. But really, kind of the one thing we want to drive home, while we've got all of these different roles and all these different objectives, you know, we are all trying to achieve one goal, and that's really healthy student chapters. And you guys are really the future of Southern District. And I know that's something that Cindy didn't directly mention, but she and I have talked about at length that, you know, the students are the future of the Southern District, because you will be the ones that will be stepping in and being new professional members going forward. So I'm going to now transition it to Robert Baker. Robert's going to talk through a little bit more on some of our committee goals and some of the resources and expectations that Southern District has for our student chapters. Robert?
Yes, thanks, Jody. Good morning, everybody. Again, my name is Robert Baker. I work with GDOT, and I've been participating in the Education and Student Chapter Committee for probably the past 5 or 6 years. It's been, you know, a great opportunity to engage with the student chapters and see you guys transition from, you know, your studies at your school, you know, into the professional workplace. So I've, you know, always been grateful for this opportunity to participate. With the Education and Student Chapter Committee, one of our main goals is to track, encourage, and support student chapter activity throughout the Southern District. And we try to do this in several ways, and it's a team effort between Southern District and the student chapter sections. One thing we definitely try to do periodically through the year is track what we call the vitality of the student chapters. This is basically a set of criteria that we pinpoint to give us a gauge of how active your student chapter is. Some of those things, well, those things are: did your chapter submit a chapter report? Have you competed in traffic bowl at your local section or at the Southern District level? Did any of your members submit a technical paper to the Southern District competition? Have any of your members attended any section meetings at your local state level? Has any of your chapters actually held your own meetings yourselves? So we sort of do that to gauge and see where the gaps are and where we could, you know, come in and help chapters, you know, come and increase their activity level. Next slide. One of our, you know, some of our resources that are available is with our competitions, we have some pretty good financial incentives with student chapters competing in our various competitions. One of our main competitions is our student chapter report competition. You know, we require that student chapters submit a report every year of their prior year's activity. And we like those reports to fit within the international ITE format that they released a few years back. I actually have a link to that that ITE website that shows all the various formats for all these competitions that we're trying to get everybody on the same page with. So with the student chapter reports, we give $100 to each student chapter that submits a report each year. So that's definitely money that, you know, you guys can use to help support your local activities. For the first place prize, we have a $250 prize, and as well as a submission into the ITE level competition. And second place, we have $150 prize. One thing that I've noticed there's some confusion with student chapter reports. You do submit some to your local chapters, and you also have to submit one to Southern District ITE. And we're fine with you submitting one report to the same report to each, but again, you got to keep in mind that we have a format that we've kind of been working with the past couple of years, handed down from ITE, and it'll put your student chapter in a better position to win, you know, the ITE level competition if it fits that format. So definitely, if you're developing student chapter reports, if you have a specific format for your local section, make sure you're aware of what the format is for the Southern District competition, and try to, you know, fit your student chapter report as closely to that format as possible to put you on a better, you know, better footing to win. We have our student chapter technical paper competitions, and it's not to be confused with the young members technical paper competition. They're sort of two different criteria, two different competitions going on. We have our graduate level and our undergraduate level technical paper competition. For our graduate level, it's the first place prize is $300 plus submission to the ITE level competition. Second place is $150. For our undergraduate, similar, first place $300, second place $150. Also, for first place graduate and undergraduate, we typically allow students the opportunity to come present at the Southern District annual meeting. We haven't been able to do so recently due to, you know, the COVID situations, but, you know, hopefully in the near future, we can probably get back to that routine and, you know, get some students some exposure of the great technical papers that they've been submitting. And I always tell students, you do papers and you work on studies as a part of your coursework. We're fine with you submitting those same papers for the competitions. So sometimes it's just a matter of knowing who to submit these papers to and you know, following through with it. And, you know, these are great incentives, and I know all students can use a little bit of cash in their pockets to do, you know, the things. So, you know, definitely reach out to myself and Jody, and so you can be aware of all the different the deadlines we have for these submissions. Our committee grades these papers, decides who gets the awards, and also passes on our first place winners to the next level of competitions. Something new that International ITE started is a student chapter momentum award competition. We haven't yet set up a financial incentive for this one, but we've been accepting these papers and submitting them to ITE. So what this paper involves is basically is for our student chapters that, you know, are up and coming or may have fallen off, you know, for a while and are getting the momentum back going. You can submit a paper and talk about, you know, the different efforts that you've taken to get your student chapter back on track and you know, involved and active. Write a paper, submit it to us. We'll grade them and we'll send them over to ITE for that ITE competition. Next slide. And here's the link where you can go and, you know, just look at and download the formats for the various competitions. And like I said, we're trying to get in line with all these formats so we can put, you know, all the Southern District students on a better footing to win the highest level competitions at International ITE. Next slide. So we, as far as input and best practices, you know, some of the things we want student chapters to get in the routine of, you know, regularly communicating with us, regularly letting us know who your elected, you know, officers are, who your faculty advisors are, and just so that we can have a good list of people that we can regularly communicate with and, you know, send these updates to, these competition deadline information to, and, you know, just create that good back and forth communication between us and the student chapters. Also, you know, we like you guys to, you know, every semester make sure that information is passed on to the next officers so that they know what resources we have available and what expectations we have as far as just the communication and the contest and whatnot. One thing we can help out is we can, you know, help connect you guys with monthly speakers, you know, as well as encourage you to engage with your local section liaisons to help you guys get, you know, monthly speakers to come in and participate in your monthly meetings. We can support you guys with professional development activities. We can, you know, we can review your resumes and we can do mock interviews with you guys. We're here at your disposal. Any requests, any help you need, you know, definitely reach out to us and we'll see how we could accommodate you. And also, you know, we can help you guys coordinate with international ITE if you have a need. If you have any questions that with getting international membership, we can help facilitate that and we can help you, you know, figure out what the process is and what you need to do on your end. And, you know, anything we haven't mentioned, you know, like I said, we're just an email away. We're just a phone call away. We definitely encourage you guys to reach out to us and also take advantage of all the incentives we have. And that's all I have. Jody?
Yeah, I think as Robert mentioned, Robert and I have kind of talked, we're kind of the backstop, right? So if you're having trouble finding speakers, if you've reached out to your local section, talked with your faculty advisor, you're still having trouble identifying speakers, obviously, we've got, you know, the many of the committees and the contacts that Cindy mentioned early in the presentation that we can help connect you with, resume reviews, mock interviews. If you need us to help draw on some of those committees to get people to you know, to be able to have enough resources to do those kind of things, you know, Robert and I are certainly here and the rest of our committee, we're here to help you guys with that. And, you know, we've got our contact information at the end of the presentation that you're more than happy to reach out to us. We want you guys to succeed. For our committee to succeed, it means that our student chapters, that you guys are succeeding. So up next, thank you, Robert. Up next, I think we've got Marcella and Ian who are going to talk about a really cool event that's coming up. If you haven't been able to attend one of these, it's a lot of fun. And I think the plan is we're back in person this year. So Marcella, I guess you're going to kick off.
Yes, thank you. And yeah, the plan is to be in person, which is very exciting. So I am the ITE president for Virginia Tech, and Ian, who's going to speak after me, is the vice president. And yeah, we're super excited to announce that we're hosting the 2022 Student Leadership Summit. The summit is going to be in February. It'll be February 25th to the 27th. So it's a 3-day conference over the weekend. And yeah, we want to invite everyone throughout the Southern District to come and attend. We're expecting about 150 student and professional attendees. And it's a really, really great opportunity for students to get to attend sessions led by industry professionals and kind of get to network with different people throughout the region. We are planning to have several professional and technical sessions where students can work on developing their leadership skills and different professional skills. And some of the technical sessions that we're planning are going to be about sustainable and equitable transportation, as well as traditional transportation engineering and some new items like emerging transportation technologies. So like I said, we're really, really excited to be having this. It's a really good place for students to come and network, meet new people, and overall just have a good time. So I'm going to hand it over to Ian now.
All right. Thank you, Marcella. Also, thanks everyone for letting us speak here. It's a great opportunity for us to get exposure. So like you all have mentioned, I've been to one of the student leadership summits. It's a great place to meet students throughout the Southern District. I went to the last in-person one at Georgia Tech. I actually met my roommate last year at that conference, as he's now a graduate student at Virginia Tech from LSU. So it's not just a networking in title, there's actual networking that happens, and it's a great event to go to. And so this is our first actual outreach to students, for the students on the call, and the student chapter liaisons. So our registration as of this week is officially open. So we're doing it in two phases, with the early bird going until January 14th. So the early bird registration will get you $15 off registration, which is $50 for students and $60 for professionals. You can also volunteer and attend for free. We have hotel blocks set up, lots of information on our website, which is here. And then for the professionals in the crowd, we've been doing a lot of work, Marcelo and I, and also Lena from UVA. We've been doing a lot of work planning so far. So we have commitments from a lot of companies and professionals from Virginia, but we're looking to expand our outreach to more Southern District oriented outside of Virginia. So if any of the professionals in the crowd are interested in attending, helping out, sponsoring, we have sponsorship packets available. Sponsorship opportunities range from, you know, general sponsorships, and as you go upwards, you can do things like lead technical sessions, professional sessions, be a keynote, all sorts of sponsorship opportunities. And we would love everyone on this call to be a part of it, whether it be professional or student. Like Marcella said, we're aiming for 150 people, which would be the most so far. The last few years, the event has been growing consistently, and we're looking to continue that growth. And we're going to have it in person, fingers crossed. We have a backup for virtual if it comes to that, but right now we're fully planning for in person. So with that, we invite everyone here to attend. We welcome your input, questions, anything that you guys have any comments on. We can, our information is in the Google Sheet that was mentioned in the chat. And following this meeting, in the next week or so, we're going to start sending out formal invitations to the student chapters. So that Google Sheet is especially important for that, so we know who to contact and when. And it's not exclusive to, you know, officers. We want as many people from every possible university that we can bring. We're trying to keep with the theme that's been mentioned throughout this call of emerging transportation, focusing on things like traditional transportation engineering, but also taking a step towards the future, like Marcella said, with equitable transportation, healthy transportation that was mentioned by the young professionals group, things like that. So it's going to be a whole a holistic conference that doesn't just focus on traditional, but helps us as young transportation leaders go into the field and go into the field as knowledgeable leaders. So yeah. If you guys have any questions, Marcel and I's information is there. Our information is on the website. You can reach out to us or anyone at Virginia Tech. So yeah, again, thank you for the opportunity, and we look forward to hearing from you guys.
Yeah, thanks, Ian. And you mentioned the sponsorship. That was one of the things I wanted to mention, because I know we do have quite a few professionals on the call as well today. Some great sponsorship opportunities. And really, when it comes to, you know, the grand scheme of things, they're low-cost sponsorship opportunities. So a great opportunity there, and a lot of fun to attend that event if you're able to make it, whether you're a student or a professional. If you're able to make it, it's a great event to attend. Just real quick, just a few calendar items. So November 17th, there'll be an email come out about a transitioning to professional member. That's a webinar that some of the Southern District leadership has done a couple of times now. And they're going to be offering that basically at the end of each semester. It really talks about how you kind of bridge that gap. It's intended for people that are graduating that semester, and talks about how you kind of bridge the gap from a student and make that transition into a professional. Not only in the skill set and things that you may need to think about, but also from an ITE perspective. Also, we're still working on nailing down the date, but week of November 29th, Robert Baker, Robert is the guru when it comes to student chapter reports. He knows what, you know, what needs to be seen. He's looked at a lot of those over the 5 or 6 years, I think, that he's been chairing the committee. So he's actually going to hold a little bit of a workshop, more of an informal Q&A for people that, you know, for student chapter leadership that wants to join in. If you have questions about what needs to be in your student chapter report, what kind of things he's looking for, we're going to get that webinar scheduled for late November, kind of trying to squeeze it in between Thanksgiving and finals, which is a very, very tight time to try to thread the needle, but we're going to try to do it. As part of the Student Leadership Summit, and I have not talked with Ian and Marcella directly about this, but we're hoping to hold a session or kind of a time to share really with Southern District leadership, ENSC committee. If Robert and I are able to make it up to the Student Leadership Summit, hopefully, you know, with us as well as some of the SDITE leadership and elected student leaders. So while Student Leadership Summit is for everyone, we may have one special, you know, one session that's really geared towards those elected student leaders. And really, that's an idea exchange. What are you guys doing? What sort of activities, outreach activities, meeting activities that you're doing as a student group? And sharing those ideas and trying to get that knowledge share occurring across our student chapters. And then again, in late April, right before finals, early April, before we get into finals for spring semester, we'll have another one of the transitioning professional member webinars coming up. So with that, I've got Cindy, Robert and I's contact information. I think Marcella has dropped hers in the chat window there as well. If you've got questions or specific comments later about the Student Leadership Summit, but also we've got a few minutes left. I just wanted to kind of open the floor for any other questions that anyone might have about student chapters, roles and responsibilities, Student Leadership Summit, anything, any questions that you may have.
Don't be shy, folks. This is a great opportunity to ask questions.
I was going to say, a great opportunity to ask questions. I will mention that I did also drop in the chat window. I think Ian mentioned the value to them of the Google Docs spreadsheet for contact information. But if you could take a few minutes, make sure that the contact information for your school is updated. Hopefully, I'm kind of giving you guys a little bit of time to think of your questions here as I go through this announcement, but make sure your contact information for your school is updated, for your professional liaison is updated. We really need a way to be able to contact our student chapters directly, and we want to be able to reach out to you guys directly. So with that, anyone have any questions?
There's a question in the chat box about, says the Student Leadership Conference is free, correct? And that is not correct.
That's right. Marcella or Ian, I think you guys had mentioned it's $50 for students if they register early. Is that correct?
Yes, that is correct. It's $50 for students until mid-January, and then it'll be $65.
And do you have a host hotel?
Yeah, so we have two host hotels. Both of the reservation blocks are on the website. I forget the prices of them. It depends. I'll speak from past experience. I'm not sure how it is for each chapter, but at Virginia Tech, we have some funds within our student organization. Turn my video set aside for things like this. So while it may not be specifically free, it may be free to students if your chapter is willing to sponsor you, or possibly other people are willing to sponsor. I remember that we were able to go for free when we went down to Georgia Tech.
That's a great point. And Christina Whitfield also mentioned, she's with NICSITE. A lot of your state sections may have funds available to help if you're a student, and your student chapter can, you know, help sponsor if there's a need there to help with travel expenses or registration. I do encourage you to go ahead and reach out to your state section and begin that conversation with them now. A lot of state sections have some money or can work with you guys to help come up with a way that if you have the desire to attend and you want to be active in that student leadership summit, that the state sections can come alongside you and help make that possible.
And speaking of that, having been through the leadership at both the T-Site and Southern District, we are all in our process of updating for our 2022 budgets. I know at our year-end board meeting in November, we will be approving a budget for 2022. And I'm sure that is also true for the sections. So you might definitely want to reach out to them now so that they can make sure that they got money in the budget to help y'all out.
Great point. We have another question here from Mark. He said the presentation covered a lot of things about student leader for the student leaders, but is there anything you'd say to other student members of ITE, student members of ITE, or their student chapter opportunities to get involved? So first of all, I would recommend you reach out and to your student chapter and see what opportunities they have. I'm sure they have opportunities, but if you're at a school that you don't have a student chapter, or if you're looking for other opportunities outside of that student chapter, reach out to your state section. They'll be able to kind of point you in the direction, or to reach out to Southern District. And I think Cindy's got some other insight here, but that state section, you can be able to reach out to them. If you don't have contacts with them, we can certainly help you get involved. But Cindy, any other thoughts or ways folks could get involved?
Yes, a couple thoughts. One is I know for sure, because I'm, like I said, with the Tennessee section and I run it locally. In your larger cities, and once again, this is for Tennessee, but some of the other folks here may be able to chime in. I know Memphis, Nashville, and Knoxville for sure, and I think Chattanooga does it too. Every month, we have a local gathering of transportation professionals. In Knoxville, we alternate months. I want to say the odd months, we do a lunch gathering, which is a PDH opportunity. And on the even months, we go and we meet for breakfast, strictly a social event. And those are open to anybody, and we invite the students. I know we used to take our interns from Knox County to it. It's just a chance to meet and find out who else you're working with locally in terms of what's going on. So there are opportunities like that, but definitely check with your section because they'll be able to tell you what's going on. We also encourage you to attend the section meetings and things. Pay attention to what's posted in the newsletters and whatnot. We're trying to get the sections to post their meetings on our calendar, which is on our Southern District website, so that you know when those are occurring. I know this coming week on Tuesday, the Alabama section is having a meeting. And later this month, I think it's, hang on here as I grab my calendar. The Tennessee section meeting is on Wednesday, the 27th in Chattanooga. Those are opportunities that I know we usually offer a reduced rate. I don't know how much, if it varies, but check in with the sections. I do know on our Southern District website, you can click on the links for the individual sections, and that might help speed things along trying to get information. But do show up at those meetings because everybody's always interested in welcoming the students and starting to develop those relationships, because that's your opportunity to get an internship or a part-time job while you're even in school still, and that can lead to full-time employment later.
Yeah, I think that's a great, Mark, that was a great question. And I think that's one of the things that I always encourage students to do is to, if they can make it to one of the section meetings, you're almost, meet some folks there and you're almost guaranteed somebody's going to ask you if you're looking for work, because everybody's always looking for great students and great folks that are about to graduate. Any other questions? Well, if not, thank you all for joining, and hopefully you got something out of this. And we will work to try to get this posted on the YouTube page. So if there's something you feel like you've missed, we'll try to get that out there. And thank you all for joining. Have a great weekend, and look forward to talking with you soon. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Jody. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thanks, everybody. Thanks for all the effort.